Here are just a few slides about a recent note in the arithmetic of graphs. A nice addition on finite simple graphs is given by the join operation. We take the disjoint union of two graphs, then take all connections from one vertex in the first to the second graph. For multiplication, we take the Cartesian product of the graph vertices and take any connection of it if it projects onto a connection on one of the graphs. We see here an example. So having an addition and multiplication produces a ring, but we need associativity. And the associativity can be quickly seen. If you add A and B, we take the disjoint union and connect any pair of vertices from A to B. When we take the sum of A times C and B times C, then we do the analog connections of the products so that C times A plus B is CA plus CB. You can now check after introducing negative graphs, this becomes a ring. So for negative graphs, they are introduced by general principles. The addition forms a monoid, and the Grothendieck completion produces then a group, so that we have an additive group. So usually we write an element now as A minus B. We cannot simplify that in general because there are additive primes in this monoid. There are graphs which cannot be written as a sum of smaller graphs, and which are not just one, like in the case of the natural numbers. A graph is a prime if its graph complement is connected, because this join monoid construction is dual to the disjoint union when we take graph complements. For example, the cyclic graph with four elements is not prime, it's the sum of two zero-dimensional spheres, and the complement also, you see that cross is not connected. But the graph with the cyclic graph with five or more vertices, there the complement is connected, and these are additive primes. So how counting with graphs works with complete graphs, so they play the role of the natural numbers, and then we can take the negative graph. We just write negative of a complete graph, as for example here negative 3, and then we can take fractions. That will be one of the things we are going to do, but we can also then use any other graph, so it's a much more rich construct. a little bit more examples. On the left we have a circular graph, to the right we have a two-point graph without an edge, and we see now the addition of a zero and a one-dimensional sphere. This gives the G plus H. This is a two-dimensional sphere, kind of like a prism kind of type, two-dimensional polyhedron, while the product has now 20 vertices. 10 was the G, so 10 times 2 is 20 vertices, and we see this kind of fatter circle. Another example, we take a cyclic graph and a complete graph with two elements, and we see on the left we see kind of like an octahedron with a north and south pole connected, and on the right it's a larger graph now with eight vertices. For the sum and products of graphs without edges, then we get complete multipartite graphs, like the utility graph. If we add this graph with three vertices and no edge, and if you take the product, we also remain in that class of graphs without edges. Then we can look at the click number. It's the cardinality of the largest click, group of vertices all connected to each other. What is nice about the click number is that it is both additive with respect to addition and multiplicative with respect to multiplication. So it counts things correctly on a dimension level. On the ring, however, it can then be zero. So we see here examples also where we subtract. So we have an example where the where the cardinality, where the click number is minus one. Think about this a little bit like a trace. And then what is important is that we can introduce a norm. So we define this just as the as an infimum over all representations of G as A minus B, and then we add up the click numbers, but the positive click numbers. We can also think about it like that. If G is given as A minus B, where this cannot be reduced, there is no common additive prime there, which allows to be deleted, then it's just the click number of A plus the click number of B. And then we extend it to the integers, we extend it then to the rationals. The rationals Q, they are all the graph fractions where C of G over H, where C of H is not zero. And the norm then behaves nicely with respect to that, at least for integers. So it's non-negative. It is zero, even only if G is zero, and it behaves nicely with the scalar multiplication. We come to that. The scalar multiplication is given by the multiplication with complete graphs or fractions of complete graphs or completion of fractions of complete graphs, because the complete graphs generate the real numbers. So this is a property which holds, and then we have the triangle inequality. So we really have a normed space, a pre-Banach space, and then we can complete that. And that's kind of the observation I wanted to get to. We get the Banach algebra over R, which is a scalar multiplication, a vector space, a linear space, and it has a norm which satisfies this Banach algebra property. So in this arithmetic, one can do everything you can do with the real numbers, like here, adding up the Fibonacci numbers and take quotients and then get to the golden mean. So in this case, there's nothing new. The actual real number 1.618033, that's kind of just illustrated here in form of graphs. But we could start with other graphs. For example, instead of two, we could start with a cyclic graph or with a wheel graph or any other graph. We could get another Fibonacci sequence, and if we start with a sequence with the click numbers are as such, then we get some object in the limit which has this limiting click number, the golden mean. Here's another example just illustrating that this is a large Banach space. I mean, it's infinite dimensional, so the unit sphere is not compact. So there are sequences of vectors, so which have distance one to each other, and they go to they never have any accumulation point. So what are the applications? First of all, one can use the products to produce new graphs from old ones. So I've done here a couple of examples with star graphs, cyclic graphs, point graphs, and path graphs, and you see that they are already quite pretty networks produced. It also forces you to think about the general structure of graphs. Some of the graph classes are monoids, like varieties or spheres. Others, like discrete manifolds, are not monoids. They are not closed under the join operation. There's a nice class, Dane Somerville class of graphs, which is closed, which is a monoid, and which has properties close to manifolds or spheres. Every odd dimensional discrete manifold is there. So this is for varieties. So this is an example of a variety. Varieties are defined in an inductive way. We start with a zero graph, which is V minus one, and then we just ask for Vn at every unit of Vn plus one. We ask that every unit sphere is in Vn. And so here we see an example that these examples appear when we take products of spheres. For example, as we have in this case taken the product of two spheres, and we got a variety. You can look at the unit spheres and you see these are not sphere, so it's not manifold-like. In this case, it's also a variety. So finally, it just can be fun. You know, when I was in high school, I started to read the book of Donald Knuth, which was in German called The Insel der Zahlen, Island of Numbers. And then I also got the book of Conway, Über Zahlen und Spiele, which is the number and games. For me, it was really nice to see how large mathematics is and how creative mathematics can be. And the math here is based on the concept of surreal numbers, which have been created by John Conway. And this is why I call this whole thing here numbers and graphs. So it's a nice thing, topic to explore and maybe find new things. This is the end. Look at my project place for a link on a document which explains this a bit more detailed.